space in which the House Democratic Caucus, working in tandem with our colleagues in the Senate and with the White House, have delivered for the American people. Delivered in terms of historic job growth, delivered in terms of lowering health care costs, delivered for veterans in enacting historic health benefits for our nation's veterans, delivered on bipartisan gun safety violence prevention legislation that was enacted just last year. There remain big challenges and big opportunities for us to address, and we look forward to working with the president in the months and the years ahead to do precisely that. But of course, there is no one who has worked harder to deliver for the American people here in the House of Representatives than our distinguished leader of the Democratic Caucus, who reminds us time and time again that our work is not finished and that it's important for us to finish the job as we work to ensure that working families across our country are represented. And so we're very, very grateful to have him here today, and we'll turn it over to Leader Jeffries.
Thank you, Chair Neguse. Good morning, everyone, and an honor and privilege to be here with all of you and with Chair Neguse and Co-Chair Escobar, Co-Chair Underwood, and Co-Chair Phillips. Collectively, the DPCC is doing an extraordinary job in making sure that we continue to communicate with the American people both what we've done as well as our vision for the future. Tonight at the State of the Union Address, as House Democrats, we're excited to welcome President Joe Biden once again to the chambers of the House of Representatives to speak directly to the American people. Yes, about our accomplishments, the American Rescue Plan, the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act, the CHIPS and Science Act, gun safety legislation for the first time in 30 years, the Respect for Marriage Act, the PACT Act to stand up for our veterans, and certainly the Inflation Reduction Act to strike a dramatic blow against the climate crisis, set our planet on a sustainable trajectory forward, stand up a clean energy economy, lower energy costs, strengthen the Affordable Care Act, drive down the high price of life-saving prescription drugs, including capping insulin at $35 a month for millions of seniors across the land. It's a track record of extraordinary accomplishment, and we'll share that continuously with the American people, not to say reward us, but to say trust us. We have your back. President Biden, Democrats in the House and the Senate will continue to work hard to put people over politics, to deliver real results for everyday Americans. And at the same time, we recognize that there is more work that needs to be done. And it's my expectation that President Biden will thoroughly and thoughtfully lay that out for the American people. We're going to build upon our track record of success and continue to fight for lower costs, for better paying jobs, for safer communities, to make sure we stand up for middle class Americans, for working class Americans, for seniors, for young people, for veterans, and for all of those Americans who aspire to be part of the great American middle class. President Biden is a blue collar president. He's a pro-union president. He's a pro-middle class president. It's in his bones. It's in his DNA. It's in his background. That is who Joe Biden is. That is who House Democrats are. And that is who we will continue to be in delivering for the people.
Thank you, Leader Jeffries. Appreciate your leadership. Buenos días a todos. Es un placer estar aquí con mis colegas para hablar sobre todo lo que hemos hecho como demócratas para americanos en cada lugar, en cada comunidad. It is such a pleasure and privilege to be here with my colleagues. We are excited about tonight's State of the Union address and to hear from the President of the United States about how Democrats deliver. As we begin the month of February, let's look back on the first month of Republicans and what they have done as they have had their opportunity to lead in the House. They told us that they wanted to fight inflation. We saw out of the gate they were fighting each other. They told us that they wanted help rebuild America. They have focused instead on tearing down the IRS, on resolutions about socialism, nothing that helps the American people, while Democrats continue to focus on delivering for the American public. We are going to hear from the president about the great work that we've done, not just over the last 2 years, but the work that we expect to do ahead. And we are willing to work with any Republican when and if they decide to put the American people first. We will continue to be the party that will be the adults in the room, the party that looks to uplifting every single American. And we will fight, though, the chaos and the extremism at every turn as it seeks to harm communities across the country. I was just meeting with the Socorro Independent School District from my community, hearing about the needs for broadband and for fundamental infrastructure to help kids learn. And I was excited to tell them about the bipartisan infrastructure law and the investments that we are going to be making in our kids, in our future, in these school districts that are on the front lines of creating a competitive America. Meanwhile, the Republican Party is talking about domestic cuts and ways to erode gains in communities like my own. Tonight, my guest will be El Paso County Attorney Joanne Bernal, who has been on the front lines of defending El Paso County against Republican attacks and efforts to limit local control. El Paso County, she as a prosecutor, has been on the receiving end of the American Rescue Plan funds that funded badly needed prosecutors for my community. So I am excited about the contrast that we will continue to see that tonight as the president lays out not just what we've accomplished, but his vision for the future so that Americans across the country know who's in their corner and who delivers, and that is Democrats. Thank you all.
Well, good morning, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us. Tonight, we're welcoming President Biden to Capitol Hill and celebrating the accomplishments that we have made together on behalf of the American people, because Democrats deliver on our promises. Over the last 2 years, we've made historic investments in our infrastructure and created millions of better paying jobs. We've made health care more affordable. We passed my legislation lowering premium prices for millions of Americans. We've given Medicare the power to negotiate lower drug prices, and we've made sure that no senior would have to pay more than $35 a month for their insulin. We've delivered on our promises to get health care to veterans facing the impact of toxic exposure and to build high-speed broadband across the country. The list goes on and on. Now, Democrats have been delivering for the American people, but we also have to be on defense. This extreme Republican majority is pushing an agenda that will devastate our communities, but Democrats are here to defend the people we represent. We passed legislation to protect the right to marry who you love, no matter their gender or race. While they try to stop us from making our own decisions about our bodies and our futures, Democrats have made it clear that we will always defend reproductive rights. And while this extreme Republican majority tries to pay for more tax cuts for billionaires and corporations by slashing Social Security and Medicare, Democrats will fight to defend these vital programs and the right to retire with dignity. My guest tonight is one of those Americans, and I'm so excited for you all to meet her. Cindy Mundell from Naperville, Illinois, is a cardiac ICU nurse who served our community for more than 30 years. She's the definition of a helper, and I am so honored to be welcoming her right here to the United States Capitol later this evening. Cindy, like millions of Americans like her, earned her retirement through decades of hard work. The cuts that Republicans are suggesting would turn her entire life upside down, but I'm here to say, not on my watch. So, as we welcome President Biden to the Capitol tonight, our message is this: Democrats deliver and Democrats defend. For people like Cindy and for people all across our communities who are counting on us to do this work. Thank you again for joining us today, and I am delighted to introduce my colleague on the DPCC, Congressman Dean Phillips.
Hi, everybody. When President Biden was elected, he promised to restore competency and reduce chaos and to restore the soul of our nation. And I want to say that again, to restore the soul of our nation. And I know that Democratic leaders behind me, Leader Jeffries and my friends on the DPCC, all Democrats, know that it's not the politicians who will populate the Capitol tonight for the State of the Union that define that soul of our country. It's the very tens of millions of Americans who will be tuning in, who face challenges and a diverse nation of extraordinary needs, opportunities, possibilities, and optimism that we intend to deliver for as Democrats. And that's true from Brooklyn Park, Minnesota, that I represent, all the way to Brooklyn, New York, that Leader Jeffries represents. It's also the guests that we're bringing tonight. And I would ask, if you have some moments over the course of this afternoon and tonight, maybe spend a little less time with us and a little bit more time with our guests. They are the soul of our country. My guest tonight is Sheriff Dewana Witt of Hennepin County in Minneapolis, whose life story and remarkable path to her position is worthy of your time. And I ask that you visit with her today and this afternoon to learn about her, what she represents, the possibilities that she represents, and how we as a country can come together over ensuring that we bring safety to everybody and not just to some. And I want to remind all of you and the country that we believe in delivering for the American people, not demeaning them. We believe in defending American freedoms and not destroying them. We believe in constructing bridges, not burning them. We believe in lifting people up, not leaving them behind. We believe in decency and not division, in cooperation and not confrontation. We believe in safety for all, like I said, not just for some. And lastly, and perhaps most importantly, we believe in competency over chaos. And if there is not a more important message for the American people and for all of us, to remind ourselves where we were just a few years ago and where we are today. A lot of macro discussion, a lot of big words, a lot of big policies and legislation, but at the end of the day, President Biden has delivered the most important thing that this country has ever needed, and that is competency in lieu of chaos. I am so honored to represent my friends in this extraordinary caucus, and I thank you for being here today. Thanks, everyone.
He's getting very excited for Dean Phillips, ABCs of Democracy. Taking the lead from Leader Jeffries. He's pretty good. So we'll take a couple of questions. Bottom line, as you all know, Democrats deliver for working people, and Democrats will defend American values each and every day under the leadership of Leader Jeffries and President Biden. So with that, we'll take a few questions. Yeah.
It's a very important question, and I think President Biden tonight and Democrats as we move forward, particularly as we implement these historic accomplishments, are going to be in conversation with the American people about the fact that Democrats have delivered meaningful change and progress for everyday Americans in a multitude of ways, whether that's infrastructure or domestic manufacturing jobs or gun safety or respecting the right to marry who you love whenever and wherever you want, saving the economy from a deep recession, certainly driving down the high price of life-saving prescription drugs for millions of Americans. And so we'll continue to be in conversation with everyday Americans. A lot has been accomplished. In some ways, it's an abundance of riches that we are now responsible to communicate effectively to everyday Americans that Democrats have delivered. And perhaps most importantly, we will continue to deliver. And as all of our wonderful DPCC members have indicated, we will also defend American values. Democrats will defend the efforts to slash and burn Social Security and Medicare. Democrats will defend democracy. Democrats will defend a woman's freedom to make her own reproductive health care decisions. And what will also be important, what I think you'll hear today, is a clear contrast between Democrats who get stuff done, who deliver for everyday Americans, and have a vision to make life better for the American people into the future, and a group of chaotic, dysfunctional, and extreme MAGA Republicans who want to turn back the clock.
Just to build on what the leader said, certainly it's a challenge, but it's also an opportunity. And I think you will see House Democrats over the course of the next several weeks and months talk more about the ways in which the historic legislation that was enacted in the prior 117th Congress is making a real difference in people's lives back home in Colorado, in Illinois, in Texas, in Minnesota, and across the country. You've also seen a signal from the White House that the president intends to get out on the road, touring 30 different cities. I believe you'll see House Democrats every step of the way as these bills are being implemented. And I know the leader has been laser focused in ensuring that they're implemented appropriately, hence the regional council committee that he just recently announced, which I think will also help operationalize some of that implementation work. Go ahead.
Understanding that President Biden will speak to the issue of safer communities, strengthening the relationship between the police and the community, making sure that there is accountability, and that's important, and I think he'll talk about that today, and also leaning into the notion that this shouldn't be a Democratic issue or a Republican issue. Strengthening the relationship between the police and communities all across America should be an American issue that both sides of the aisle, both sides of the Capitol should lean into. And I think there's reason at least to be somewhat optimistic that there are ongoing conversations being led by the Congressional Black Caucus, as well as members of the Senate, such as Tim Scott and Cory Booker. And we'll support those efforts, we'll support those conversations. I think the president and the administration are prepared to do the same, and hopefully we'll be able to do something meaningful to address the legitimate concerns that exist across America with police violence, while also making sure we lean in to strengthening the ability for law enforcement to provide for safer communities. The overwhelming majority of police officers that I encounter back at home in Brooklyn and throughout New York City are hard-working individuals who are in the community to protect and serve. And I think you'll see House Democrats continue to lean in to strengthening those relationships while bringing about accountability when things go wrong.
Our response is that we are pragmatic and we're focused on solutions, problem solving. And yes, we got a problem. We got to solve it. In fact, I think it's actually the opposite of what you just said. We're very much focused on ensuring that the trust funds have the resources necessary. These are not entitlements. These are programs that are benefiting people who paid into them. They've earned these. And we have a collective obligation to ensure that those trust funds are solvent and have the resources necessary to take care of people. But until we have partners who are willing to sit down and actually talk about it, it's awfully difficult in an institution of democracy like the one behind us to get that done. So we're going to extend invitations rather than just inspire confrontations on this subject. Under no way, shape, or form will Democrats ever deny people what they have earned and paid into. And there are a lot of ways to solve this problem. We're ready to do so. And I encourage our friends across the aisle to sit down and do so with us.
All right. One or two more questions? Yes?
Talking to Republicans yesterday, they were saying that the State of the Union, because they're reflecting on last week, said the president has not delivered on a promise of bipartisanship. Do you think there was something with things like the debt ceiling that's right now?
I'm going to turn it to my colleagues. I would just simply say, I think the leader has been very clear, Leader Jeffries, that we would extend a hand to the Republicans to offer to work with them in a collaborative way to address the consequential challenges that we face as a country. There'll be multiple opportunities to do that, the FAA reauthorization, the Farm Bill perhaps being two salient examples. What we won't do is engage in political games over the debt ceiling, which clearly is what the Republican Party in the House is focused on right now, and put the full faith and credit of the United States and the sacrosanct commitment that we have to pay our debts, in addition to our status as the world's reserve currency, all on the line so that they can engage in potentially draconian cuts to Social Security, to Medicare, incredibly important programs. So I think that we will always be working towards trying to find a bipartisan solution to some of these challenges, but ultimately it'll take a governing partner to do that, and the Republicans, as Veronica, as Congressman Escobar articulated in the beginning, doesn't seem like they're particularly inclined to do that. So hope springs eternal. With that, I'll turn it over to Coach Underwood.
You know, that kind of statement lacks a lot of credibility. When we say Democrats deliver, it's because we did it. We passed the bipartisan infrastructure law that all across Illinois is rebuilding roads and, you know, dealing with water infrastructure issues, which literally every municipality that I represent has a water issue, and so we're taking care of business there. We obviously have delivered when it comes to historic bipartisan gun safety legislation, which folks thought was not possible. But on the heels of a catastrophic tragedy, we were able to come together here on Capitol Hill to get it done. And so, you know, that kind of statement to me just lacks credibility when what we've seen from this Republican majority is just weeks and weeks and weeks of chaos at the beginning of a Congress, in stark contrast to what we have to offer to the American people.
This is really important. You know, we don't wake up and think, how can we stonewall our friends across the aisle? Yeah. You know, most of us are new to Democratic leadership and have had a few meetings so far. That is not the spirit of our table. It's actually the opposite. It's where can we find ways to work together, because that is our responsibility. I believe I'm the only member of leadership on either side of the aisle that's also a member of the Problem Solvers Caucus. I sit with my Republican colleagues every single week, the ones who are willing to actually try to find a path forward. So I think bipartisanship is, it is important. I think the president has tried his darndest to inspire it, but bipartisanship cannot occur when one party has a mandate to stonewall consistently, no matter how important. So we're wanting to. I don't know any friends on my side of the aisle who are not willing to work with anybody that wants to solve these problems. If my colleagues on the DPCC and I here can inspire nothing else in this entire Congress but for working together, then we will have failed. And I know that's the spirit of Leader Jeffries and so many of us. And that's our invitation. And I hope that's the spirit of tonight as well.
Last question.
Well, you know, obviously have not previewed his speech for tonight, and I understand where Speaker McCarthy is coming from. And if anyone has extended an olive branch to rebuild relationships and to create pathways for unity, it's been President Joe Biden. But I will tell you, the elephant in the room, and something that Speaker McCarthy cannot wave away or pretend doesn't exist, is the fact that the Republican Party of yesterday, of the Republican Party of a decade ago, a generation ago, it doesn't exist anymore. As we saw in that week that it took for the speaker election to take place, and the reason why Congress is off to such a slow start is because of the chaos that ensues when the most extreme voices gain control of a political party. That is why bill after bill after bill that's come to the House floor has had absolutely nothing to do with addressing the challenges that we face as a country, challenges that we all stand ready to work alongside them with. And so, you know, I expect President Biden's speech tonight to call on our better angels, call on us to work together, but it also has to reflect the reality of the challenge that comes with the obstructionism that the most extreme voices have brought to this institution. And so, as all my colleagues have mentioned, we stand here ready to continue to deliver for the American public, but also to defend against those extremist voices, whatever they are called at the end of the day.
Thanks, everybody. Thank you all for coming out.
Stay warm.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Hey, Galen. How are you? Are we walking? Where are we going?
Actually, can I ask you a quick question?
Sure.
I was going to say, of course, I just dropped it. Yes. Awesome. Thank you. Really appreciate it.
Where are you going?
Julius, by the way. Evan, nice to meet you. Oh,